here up front.
I'm up front.
How about the people up back? Jim, can you hear me over here? Excellent, good. Oh, an SATV scale. So, welcome to the House of the Seven Gables. Thank you all for coming. My name is Kara McLaughlin, and I'm the director here, and we're really pleased to have you, especially on this Thanksgiving weekend. I see a lot of new faces here in the audience, and I'm really pleased to have you. I'd like to give a little bit of history about our organization, because people are often surprised to hear a little bit about it. Most people have heard of the House of the Seven Gables. They know it has something to do with Nathaniel Hawthorne, but what they don't know is it's one of the oldest timber frame mansions here in North America. It was built in 1668, which was basically just about 350 years old. More about that later. So it served as the inspiration for Hawthorne's novel, but which later opened as a museum and a settlement house by a woman named Caroline Emerton. She's actually our founder. She saw an opportunity to do two things. One, preserve the historic house, as well as several others that we have here on the property. But also, she saw a way to help the people that were settling in here in the neighborhood and in Greater Salem. People that were coming from other countries, the immigrants. The settlement house movement was a popular way of doing that back in the turn of the 20th century. So she opened the house as a museum, used proceeds from museum tours to fund educational programs such as English language lessons, citizenship classes, life skills classes, cooking, carpentry, etc. People that were living mostly here in this neighborhood, they were primarily coming from Eastern Europe and Russia at the time. This settlement work and the preservation work are both things that we focus our efforts on here today as well. So in addition to preserving this National Historic Landmark campus that I hope you all have a chance to enjoy, we also provide programming to help our immigrant community, such as adult English language and citizenship classes, summer school programs for English language learners, and we also host a series of community conversations on the topic of immigration and immigration reform that I hope you all find some time to join us in next year. So, speaking of next year, I mentioned we'll be celebrating the 350th anniversary of the House of the Seven Gables, and we have a whole year of celebration planned. A couple of examples off the top of my head. Our exhibit will be themed These Walls Do Talk, How We Know What We Know About the House of the Seven Gables. That opening will happen in April, and the exhibit will be on display through at least September, if not longer. We'll have some other programming, such as a staged reading of The House of the Seven Gables, love letters of Nathaniel Hawthorne and Sophia Peabody Hawthorne, a music festival, 4 centuries of music. So keep your eyes peeled. The calendar of events will be coming out soon. I hope you can come for one or more of those events. We would not be able to do any of these things without the help of many people. Our visitors are an example, and we'd like to ask for your support. You can support us by visiting. You can support us by shopping in our store. You can support us by becoming a member of the House of the Seven Gables. How many members do we have here today? Great, so lots more of you can become members, though. You may have also noticed on your chairs we have our annual appeal, and we kindly ask that you can consider supporting us in that way as well. So I thank all of those of you that are members and that have supported us. I would be remiss not to thank the people that helped make today possible, including our dedicated staff, Julie Arison Bishop. You saw her outside. She's a big person. She's a big reason we have all of these programs, because she plans a lot of them. I also want to thank Karen Barty. You can see her here. She's our development director, soon to be retired, but we still have her. There are a lot of people that make it possible for us to have these events, our ground staff, our event staff. I want to thank SATV. They're here often covering our programming, and we really appreciate that. And of course, I want to thank Brinoni and Barry for being here. Karen actually was the first person to bring Brinonia here to speak, am I right? So I'm going to allow Karen the privilege of introducing Brinonia to us.
So. Thanks, everybody. It's so great to see such a crowd. It's wonderful. I have to have my little notes here. I can't stand up as Kara does. and just so eloquently wing it. So I'm just going to take a minute. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
All right, I'm going to put this back in this thing. Still hear me okay?
Yeah. No.
No. You're right, Fred, how can you not hear me? Turn it up. It is my honor and privilege to have Brenonia here, have her as a friend, and just to experience the talent that she has in her writing is just a wonderful offshoot of my position here at the Gables to meet the authors. And a little over a year ago, Brew called me and said, would you like to be one of my readers? And I said, oh my goodness. And it was The Fifth Petal had not launched yet, and she gave me a preliminary copy. And every night I would sit in bed and read it and think, it was just such a treat to read a book before it was out to the public. So it's truly my honor to be here. Brenonia Barry, is a New York Times best-selling author, international and domestic, The Lace Reader, that was the first one, The Map of True Places, which she wrote here under our arbor, and now The Fifth Petal. Her work has been translated into more than 30 languages, and has been an Amazon Best of the Month, and also a People Magazine pick. She was the first American author to win the International Women's Fiction Festival Bacchante Award. Other awards include the Ragdale Artist Colony Stranad Invitational Fellowship, also the New England Book Festival's Award for Best Fiction. Most recently, and this is, you're about the first public crowd, I think, to hear this, the Strand magazine, which features mystery novels, named The Fifth Petal the Book of the Year. And that's it. Really excited about that. Her reviews and articles have appeared, or reviews and articles of her writing have appeared in the London Times, the Washington Post, and the Huffington Post. Brenonia co-chairs Salem Athenaeum's Writing Committee and was also executive director of Salem Literary Festival in 2014 and 2015, part of which we had right here. She lives in Salem with her husband Gary Ward and their dog Angel. And I'm going to read to you one of the reviews. There are so many on The Fifth Petal, but one of the reviews that really resonated with me was this one from Booklist Starred Review. The superlative Barry creates a vividly eerie, time-bending landscape that stretches back and forth between Salem's witch trials, the goddess murders, and the present-day mystery. This spooky, multi-layered medley of mysteries is sure to be a bestseller. Without further ado, let's give a Gables welcome to Brenonia Barry.
Hi, everyone.
Hi.
Thank you, Karen, and thank you, Kara, and Julie, and everyone at the Gables. I have to say, I have quite a history with this place. Not only did I get to write The Map of True Places here, which was quite an honor, but I started out, I was born in Marblehead, but across the harbor. And so I was fascinated by the House of Seven Gables since I was a little kid. And we used to have a Boston Whaler on our side of the harbor. And, you know, before you could drive, you could take your boat over here. So I used to come and wander around and try to break in. But this is a story that a few of you, I know Julie has heard this, but I'm not sure a lot of people have. My first job that I ever had was at the House of Seven Gables. I was 16 years old, and I was a substitute tour guide at the end of the season when all the college kids had gone back to school, and I was 16, and my mother had gotten me the job. And I had, of course, read the book, The House of Seven Gables, and I'd read all the notes they'd given me, but probably not as thoroughly as I should. And I was leading a tour on the second day of my job through the secret room. Now, let me just say, I was embellishing a bit. And I had, the audience was rapt, and I thought, I've got fun, this is great. And when I got to the bottom of the stairs, my boss came over and said, Miss Barry, you can go home now. So I was fired for embellishment. But I didn't want to go right home because I was embarrassed. It was my first job ever, and my mom had gotten it for me. And so I walked over to the Salem Library and sat there all day. And, you know, a 16-year-old sitting in the library all day is kind of suspicious. And the second day when I did it again, the librarians got quite interested. And at the end of each day, I would walk back here so my mom could pick me up. So I don't know why I thought my mother wouldn't find out. And because she'd gotten the job for me from a friend that she knew. And of course, after a few days, the friend called and said, how's your daughter doing? And my mother said, what? She did find out, of course. But she said at that moment she knew I was going to be a fiction writer. And she's always called it embellishment rather than lying, which essentially it was. So it was really a thrill to be offered space to write the fifth Map of True Places, and also to be back here for the fifth panel. So thank you all. As you know, I live in Salem now, and I was born in Salem, of course, because Salem Hospital, so I can claim that. But I don't think we'll ever leave. We moved here 20 years ago, coming back from California. We'd been in Los Angeles, and when we came back to the East Coast, we thought, what place is as wild and crazy and open as LA? And guess what? So I'm going to read somewhat, a little bit to you today. I'm going to do three readings from the fifth petal. And I want to talk a bit about the writing experience. How many of you are writers or wannabe writers or journalers? Great. Well, then you'll know what I'm talking about. I work in a house on Warren Street that was owned by artists. And they lived there for 37 years and raised their family there. And I work in a room that was their son's room. And it's covered, the walls are covered with National Geographic maps. It's just fantastic. And some of the countries don't exist anymore. They've been renamed and redrawn. And it's just a great place. It has four huge windows and a fireplace. And I can look down the street at beautiful gardens that all belong to my neighbors. I couldn't grow a darn thing. But I get the benefit of looking at their gardens. And every time I write a different book, I start collecting things for this writing room. So with the fifth petal, it was, with the lace reader, let's start with that. It was lace, of course. I had a chapter about the red hats in there, and the original chapter of red hats gave me a feather boa and red gloves, and of course I had my own red hat. And so I've collected things all along. I collected a kit to learn to make bobbin lace, which was the image system for my book. It's completely knotted up, stuffed in the back of a closet now. But these are the kind of things, you know, you start collecting things when you start writing a book, and it becomes a shadow box of your creativity, I think, at least for me. I'm lucky I have a whole room dedicated to my writing. But at the end of every book, I clear out the room, and I start on the next book. So the image system for the lace reader was, of course, lace. For the second book, The Map of True Places, it was celestial navigation. And I have to say I had a little harder time learning that, but the people down at the Park Service helped me quite a bit. And the resources in Salem were quite amazing. After the lace reader came out, my editor said, write a completely different book, but stay in Salem. Go. And you have 2 years. And my first tour lasted almost a year. So I just kept walking around Salem until I figured out what the second book would be. And I think there's a story, there's a history lesson and a story around just about every corner here. So what a great place to live. For the third book, The Fifth Petal, The writing of the book coincided quite a bit with the, not discovery of Proctor's Ledge, but the dedication of it and a lot of the research that went into finally dedicating the place where the hangings of Salem actually happened in 1692. So that became a big part of the book. I do have to say that when you're writing about Salem, you better get it right. Mm-hmm. You know, I thought fiction writer, I can write anything I want. Oh, no, no, no. There are so many historians in town, and they're a great resource, but you really better do your homework. So this book took 5 years to write, and most of that, I think probably three of them were research into all sorts of different things, not just Salem history, but everything else that went with it. So just to talk about the difference between writing the books, you know, everything changes, and I've written three books about Salem, and Salem's changed a lot in the time. The first book was set in 1995, and the latest was 2014. So if you think of the way Salem has changed, it's been quite remarkable. One of the biggest ways, of course, is we've been discovered for our real estate and how the prices are slightly lower than Boston, Cambridge, and so that's been interesting. But change has been a very big issue in the books as well as in my writing room. You know, I change out everything, I start again, and I end up with a completely different room. I think they say the only constant in life is change, but there's another constant in the life of a writer, and that's really the question. And I want to talk a little bit about the questions today. I think learning to live in the question is something we're doing more and more of these days because we don't really know answers to things. Well, the older I get, I realize the less I know. So, but I think as a writer, you always start a book with a question. And it's usually a what-if question. So, for example, The Lace Reader began with the question, what if a young woman who'd left her home to save herself and her sanity had to go back to save someone she loved? So that was The Lace Reader. And that really mimicked my own journey in a way. We were living in California at the time, and my dad was diagnosed with Parkinson's. And he was my mom's caregiver. She was wheelchair-bound with rheumatoid arthritis. And we'd been talking about coming home every year, and we'd come home every summer and visit, and we have a house in New Hampshire as well, and we would fall in love with New England all over again and say we're moving back. And then we'd come home right about now, at the holidays, and I'd be wearing long underwear under my dress, and we'd go, maybe next year. So this went on for quite a while, until my dad was diagnosed, and he said, if you're coming, come now. So we were back here within about 6 weeks, I think it took us to.
Wow.
And just fell in love with it, and I fell in love immediately with Salem, and thought, why has nobody been writing about this? And of course, a lot of people have written about it, but I wanted to write about it with some authenticity that I hadn't seen from other writers at that point. So that was the question that started The Lace Reader. Other questions, of course, emerge as you write a book. I do think it's a writer's job really to ask difficult questions, but not necessarily to answer them. You have to, of course, tie up your plot. And I'm writing mysteries now, and so you better tell them who done it, or you will, they'll never buy your book or read another one that you do. Or throw the book across the room is what I heard, if you don't tell them. But there are questions, more philosophical questions, that I don't think really are our job to answer. I think our job is to pose the questions and let the readers decide how they want to answer them. I'm told lately that fiction writing, particularly literary fiction, but I think it really goes for most fiction, creates empathy. And I hope that's right. I think storytelling has always been one of our ways to maybe be able to have a discussion on something that isn't quite so personal and so fraught with tension. So I think story this is how I justify writing fiction, of course. But I think it's true. I hope it's true. So that was the question that prompted the first book. The second book was written, and Salem had changed quite a bit. the map of True Places was 10 years later. And our world had changed quite a bit. 9/11 had happened. We were in the middle of a big financial crisis. All sorts of things were changing, and our maps of our world were changing too. So the question that I was asking in that book was, what if a psychologist crossed an ethical boundary that might have resulted in a patient's death? That was the question. I had a niece who was studying to be a psychotherapist at the time and was involved with a lot of ethics classes, and I was really lucky enough to be able to have access for research to her classes, who helped me quite a bit with this book, because it really was a book about ethics. The ultimate question that emerged with that book was, what do we do when the maps of our life suddenly fail us and we're forced to find our way through unfamiliar territory on our own? And I started thinking, what is it that doesn't change? We're moving so fast, but what holds steady for us? And the image system that came to mind was the stars. Now, not that they're not moving, of course they are, but to us standing here, it looks like they are a constant. So that became the image system there. The new book's a little different. The new book is set in three different time periods, in 1692, in 1989, and in 2014. And it's three different mysteries. And I will just tell you the question that came to me, and I'm going to do three readings from the book. The question that prompted this was, could a witch hunt happen again in Salem? And, you know, that's not something you probably think about all the time. The only time I really think about it is Halloween, because we have so many people here, and I don't really think. I think this last place something like that could happen. But, you know, it is happening all over the world still. And this town actually helps other towns. I know the some of the people are sponsoring, the people at the Witch House are sponsoring a shelter in Africa for children who are being accused of witchcraft. So there is quite a bit going on. But we are the center. You know, there were thousands of witch hunts in Europe, and yet we're the one that people remember. So I think we have a certain responsibility there. I'm going to read you a synopsis of the book. On Halloween night in 1989, three young women were murdered while attempting to consecrate the hanging site of their ancestors, executed during Salem's witch hysteria of 1692. When a similar murder happens in 2014, Police Chief John Rafferty wonders whether an accused homeless person is really to blame, or if this is yet another Salem witch hunt, and realizes he must solve both murders in order to identify the real killer, who may or may not be human. So obviously you see there's a little of the occult and quite a bit of mystery there. The question is, could something like that happen again here? It wouldn't look the same, of course, but we hear the words witch hunt bandied about quite a bit these days, and I think it's important to realize what we mean when we talk about witch hunts. Salem is a haven, as we know. Now, when I go elsewhere, you all know all this, but when I go elsewhere, I actually take a slideshow with me to show people the different sites and to try to explain what Salem is, because most of what people see are movies that are quite dramatized, but they don't see what it's like now. And it has become a haven for neo-witches, not in spite of our history, but really largely become of it. But every time at Halloween, I worry about things. I'm going to read you a little bit of from three different characters. The main characters in the book are John Rafferty, who is the chief of police. If you have read my first two books, you will recognize him. He was a detective who initially moved to Salem from New York City because he wanted a more peaceful life. And of course, what he's found is anything but that. He's now chief of police. It's interesting to write a fictional story about a real place, because he's not chief of police, of course. But people ask when I go someplace else, well, how does Mr. Rafferty like you writing about him? So I have to say that everything in the books, every location is fictional, because I found out with the first book that people go looking for the locations, and they were knocking on doors. So that's something I've learned not to do. And And all the people are fictional. But hopefully the world I'm describing is accurate, and as you read it, I'd love to hear your opinions. I know there are a few stretches I've made. One was a very long swim in my first book. And the second was a very long walk in this book, which cost me an assistant. I made an assistant walk, I'm going to read this part, but walk from this side of the Beverly Bridge over to Prize Crossing, and she quit. She was game to do it, but she didn't last. I don't know why. Anyway, so that's essentially what the synopsis of the book is. Now, of course, the theme of the book is very different. When I went to the Concord bookstore, the owner told me, you have to read this particular quote from your book anytime you speak, because it tells what the book is really about. Once you start demonizing groups of people, when you make them other, you can justify doing just about anything to them, can't you? Look at history if you don't believe me. Mm-hmm. And that's what I was trying to talk about in this book. So in this book, the other is Rose Whalen, and she is mentally ill. She was found at the site of the 1989 murder of three of her friends, her young friends, who lived with her, and has been blamed by the people of Salem for years, although she never was convicted of anything. It's all circumstantial. But when another death happens in 2014 on Halloween, and Rose confesses to it, the town wants justice. So this is a little bit different way to dramatize a witch hunt. Only a few people believe in Rose's innocence. John Rafferty, chief of police, and Callie Cahill, who is the daughter of one of the victims. Now, she actually believed that Rose was dead. She was raised in Western Massachusetts by nuns after the 1989 murder of her mother, and was told that Rose was dead. And she finds out at the beginning of the book that Rose is still alive and in trouble again, and she comes back to Salem to see if she can both clear Rose's name, but also find out what happened to her mother back in 1989. So other questions, of course, come up in the writing of the book. But I'm going to go over some of the readings with the characters and introduce you to the characters. Callie and John Rafferty are really the main characters, but I will read you something from Rose's point of view, too, who is my absolute favorite character I've ever written. So I'm going to read you what I read other people about what Salem is like here on Halloween, as if you don't know. But you can correct any errors I have. Rafferty had never seen so many trick-or-treaters on Chestnut Street, nor had he ever been charged with escorting such a large witch's march up to Gallows Hill. There were at least 150 of them this year. Wiccans, Druids, Celts, nature mama hippies with psychic tendencies, pantheists and polytheists all, walking slowly behind his 1980 Crown Vic cruiser, the one he'd rescued from the junk pile. For safety reasons, several streets had been blocked off. Traffic was already backed up onto Highland Avenue as visitors streamed into town for the festivities. He'd been living in Salem for almost 20 years now. Back in the 90s, only summer and early fall were filled with tourists. By midsummer, you couldn't find a parking space anywhere downtown, which was a pain in the ass. But come November 1st, you could park anywhere you wanted. Not so anymore. This was no longer a forgotten seaport, no longer an aging industrial city. Salem had been discovered, and not just as a tourist destination, but as the new hot place to live. These days you were lucky to get a parking space in town at any time of year, which is why Rafferty always drove the cruiser, even on his day off. As chief of police, he could double park anywhere. More often than not, a tourist would ask him to pose next to the cruiser so they could capture a witch city logo, a police badge emblazoned with a flying witch on a broomstick wearing a pointed hat. But all that was nothing compared to what happened here in October. The city had been dubbed the Halloween capital of the world. Well, that was no big surprise. But no one had expected it could turn into a month-long celebration. Lately, it was even more than a month, which was great for the merchants, The population grew by at least 300,000 each October.
Wow.
Every year, Salem imported extra police from Boston and Lynn and as far away as Connecticut, and each year they were still shorthanded. The crowds tonight were something. Even here in this residential neighborhood, the trick-or-treaters were waiting in long lines for their candy at the federal mansions that were decorated for the occasion. Fall had come late this year, but now the air was chilling and the darkness felt pervasive. He turned on his siren and pulled out, blocking incoming cars on Essex Street so the parade could cross the road. As the candlelight vigil moved on, a driver blasted his horn and others joined in chorus to protest the delay. The witches walked in formation as slowly as brides. Once the last witch had crossed the road on the way up to Gallows Hill Park, Rafferty's escort duties were over. He circled the city, checking on the rental cops and mounted police, turning onto Boston Street. Costumed children roamed more freely here, mostly without their parents. The little ones sugared up and bouncing, the older kids just looking for trouble. He spotted a few teens hanging out in the parking lot of an auto body shop on Boston Street. They scattered when they saw him coming, probably a drug deal. There have been a lot of that lately in the area. As always, the pedestrian-only walkway was full of revelers, pirates, sexy witches, monsters, and zombies, lots of zombies. The undead outnumbered the pirates and witches about 10-1. From the middle of the crowd, he could hear the amplified voices of the evangelists preaching fire and brimstone to the revelers, damning their souls to hell unless they repented and stopped partying. They'd added drums this year and cymbals. They clanged each time a preacher mentioned hell. The partiers were laughing and applauding. Didn't seem like there'd be any altercations between the groups tonight. At a gathering on the corner, Rafferty saw a family wearing homemade costumes that featured bloody stumps where their limbs should have been. They were pulling a little red wagon full of body parts. He watched another man who stood on the sidelines dressed as an oven, complete with burners that turned off and on. I have to say those first turned true. A very convincing set of duct-taped Siamese twin dogs ran in front of his cruiser, nipping at each other's faces, frustrated by their unnatural confinement. Before you yell at me, that's not true. The usuals were present in the counter for two. The Frankensteins and mummies posing for photos at their regular posts by the Peabody Essex Museum. Out-of-touch vampires still sporting sparkling glitter in homage to Twilight. They'll be zombies next year, Rafferty thought. Vampires were getting passé in Salem. He felt sorry for some of the store owners, the ones who paid rent for shops no one could get to through these crowds. It happened every year. Dozens of fortune tellers set up their booths on Essex Street, right in front of the year-round shops that were vying for the same customers. The competition between the resident and visiting psychics had been a big problem a few years back. As a result, Salem now licensed its psychics before allowing them to set up their temporary booths in October. How the hell do you license a psychic? Rafferty had asked when he heard about the plan. I mean, do you have them do a reading and then just wait a few months? We'll follow San Francisco's lead, the town clerk had told him. We're going to use their psychic licensing standards. Of course we are, Rafferty had laughed. Believed he didn't have to figure out how to do something so ridiculous. It turned out that all they had to do was check criminal backgrounds before granting licenses. Anyone without a pass could now read the future. So that's the introduction to Salem that I usually read on tour. And usually what I say is, now you've heard it and you don't have to come in. People keep coming. They all have to come in, so I haven't done my job, I think. So anyway. That's an introduction to Rafferty, and he is sort of a voice of reason, but he's also married to one of Salem's lace reader from the first book, Towner Whitney. Mm-hmm. So he's straddles between the worlds somehow, but he still has to bring justice to Salem. So that's Rafferty's character. The next one I'm going to read to you is Callie. And as I said, Callie is one of our main characters. She's in her 20s. She's a music therapist. I was lucky this time out. I have a lot of nieces. Last time out, one was becoming a psychiatrist, and this time out, one was becoming a music therapist. And she was studying at Berklee School of Music. And she was also studying sound healing. And are you aware of, have any of you used the bowls, the singing bowls? So in Salem, I'm not surprised, but I have to explain it to a lot of people. I actually have two very large crystal singing bowls that I use to treat my asthma, and it works fairly well, I have to say. And I got them from a massage therapist, but you can get them on Amazon. I don't recommend them for books. But
explain a steam.
Singing bowl.
A singing bowl.
And these are made out of quartz crystal. And one I have is, which is tuned to the heart chakra, is about this big, or I would have bought it. I'm also relatively clumsy, so you probably have made it into the room. But it's something I've worked with. I actually have that in my office in front of my window, and you play it with a rubber wand, but you play the outside of the bowl, but as I stand in front of the window playing it, it occurs to me that probably my neighbors think it's a cauldron. So I moved away from the window now. Anyway, Callie, when she comes back to Salem, Rose Whalen, who is the other in the book, has confessed to murdering, she says, by screaming at him, by sound, a teenage boy who was harassing her. Harassing a homeless woman, and you'll have to read the book to find out. There's of course much more to the story than that, but Rose believes that she can kill people by making loud noises, and that she is a banshee. So Rose is Irish, and I don't know how many are Irish here. Do you have banshees in your family?
Exactly.
We were always told we had a family banshee, and I was always very pleased. I don't want to see her ever. So Rose has an Irish background, and Rose was once an historian and a scholar who wrote books about colonial Salem, and in particular the Salem witch trials. But she has experienced very severe complex trauma when her friends were killed, and she is at the time that Kelly comes back. In 1914, catatonic in Salem Hospital in the psych ward. And no one, she's been treated by Zee Finch, who is a psychiatrist, who happened to be in my second book. And characters recur, you may notice. But Zee hasn't had much luck with her. And when Callie comes back, Callie is a music therapist and a sound healer, and she brings a large quartz crystal bowl in with her to see if she can wake Rose up. So I will read a bit about that. Callie was unfazed by the looks on the faces of the nurses at the psych ward desk when she passed by carrying the bowl and the wand. The officer guarding Rose's room looked up at her suspiciously. "What are you planning to do with that?" The nurses had not passed him the word. "I'm going to make some music," she said. "I have permission." He looked doubtful, but he let her pass. Callie did a quick scan of the room. Nothing was out of place. No one had interfered with Rose's things. Good. She set the bowl on Rose's bedside table and then moved the table to the middle of the room to center it as best she could within the four walls. After striking the bowl to create a vibration, she slowly drew the wand around the rim until the sound built and the bowl began to sing. She kept circling until the ringing grew loud enough to ripple the surface of the water in the pitcher by Rose's bedside. She could see the tiny waves in the half-empty IV bag that hung by Rose's bed, and she could feel the rolling sensation as the ellipse formed and began to move around the room. There was only one window. It was a small one and high up, barely interrupting the expansive wall. With the door closed, the sound was contained by the four walls of this square room, playing off their smooth surfaces, creating what felt like an eternity of sound. She imagined she could see the sound moving, see the colors it created as it passed over and through Rose's still body. For just a moment, she thought she saw Rose shiver, and then, as quickly as a blink, Rose's body went still again as the door opened. Standing there were the day nurse and the aide. Behind them, the officers stood tentatively. "Come in or go out," Callie said to them as the sound began dissipating. The nurse and the aide stepped inside, but the policeman went back to his post, closing the door behind him. Callie once again pulled the wand around the rim, and this time the bowl was primed. The newcomers watched open-mouthed as the sound built until it was almost unbearable, then circled the room once more. Callie put down the wand and watched Rose. She could feel the scar on her palm begin to throb where she had held the tool. Unconsciously, she rubbed at it, never taking her eyes off of Rose. The shiver she had seen earlier, if that's what it had been, did not return, but the vibration continued for a long time, longer than Callie imagined it could, and far longer than the first time, before the door had been opened. Neither the aide nor the nurse moved until the sound had faded and disappeared. The aide spoke first. "What is that supposed to do? Is it meant to heal her?" "It's intended to balance her," Callie said, without turning away from Rose. "Fascinating," the nurse said, not really meaning it. She went back to the front desk. The aide remained, looking from Callie to Rose and back. Finally, she too turned and walked out. Callie could see no sign that the shiver she thought she'd seen earlier had been real. Rose appeared exactly the same. "Come on, Auntie Rose," she whispered, as much prayer as command. "Come back to me." She walked over to the door and closed it again, standing in the room. Once again, she began to play. It took a while for the vibration to build, but when it did, Callie could feel it, not only in her fingers, but in every bone and muscle. She played until her wrist throbbed and her back muscles ached from bending over the bowl. Then, just as she was about to give up, she saw the shiver again. She circled the rim once more, forcefully, leaving a trail of rubbery dust around the edge of the bowl. She joined the sound with vowel tones, creating a shifting harmonic as it moved up and down the scale. Om, ah, e. Finally, her voice found Rose's home note, weak though it was, and she held the tone. The volume circled and built until it was so loud that Callie had to will herself not to cover her ears. At its peak, she stopped and stood perfectly still, letting the sound fade to an extended silence, a stillness that sound healers consider sacred. Rose blinked. Callie stared at her as the silence held, wishing someone else was with them to bear witness. "Rose?" Rose coughed once, then looking straight ahead, she began to speak. "I am a cipher." Callie stared. "I carry no weight, no worth, no influence. I represent nothing. I do not exist." It was as if Rose were speaking to someone or something beyond the realm of sight. Then slowly she sat up in bed, tripping an alarm that had replaced the four-point restraints. The aide and the nurse burst into the room, pushing past Callie as they hurried to Rose's bedside. "Careful," the nurse said, holding Rose to support her. "Let me help you." Rose pulled back as if stung. "It's okay," the nurse said. "You're okay." Rose hissed at the nurse, pointing a witchy index finger. "You turn away when you pass me on the street." The guard was now standing in the doorway. Rose turned to the aide. "You run from me when you should embrace me." The aide took a step backward. "But remember this as you flee. You brought me into existence. I'm not the cause, I'm merely the effect." The aide stepped back and the nurse let go of Rose. "I'm going to call Dr. Finch." The policeman stayed at the door, as if nailed there. Rose turned to look at Callie, staring for a long moment, and then slowly, her eyes filled with tears, and she reached for Callie's hand. So that's your introduction to Rose. Rose is, as I said, my favorite character in the book. Callie's experience with Rose was really a mother figure to Callie, when her own mother was too young and too involved with other things to really take care of her. The night of the murders in 1989, Rose pushed Callie into some bushes and told her to stay there and not come out. It's a little like Bambi, actually. Like that story, "Don't come out until I come back for you," and then Rose never came back for her. The nuns found at St. James found her the next day, and then she was taken to an orphanage to grow up. But she's always considered Rose her aunt and really more of a mother figure than her own mother was. That's Callie, and most of the book is from her point of view. Quite a bit from Rafferty's, too. The last character I really want to fully introduce is Rose. And as I started the book, Rose really was going to be the main character. But she's catatonic for part of the book. It's really hard to write from a point of view of a person. And also, really, the main thing about Rose is the reaction that the people in the town have to Rose. So I think that that was important. So I had to find other characters. And Callie and Rafferty stepped up, so I was lucky. So I just want to step aside for a minute and say, the first time I spoke was to the Society of University Women in Georgetown. And I was the warm-up act for Andre Debuse. And I said, I have to announce that my character spoke to me. And he yelled from the back of the room, there's a medication you could take for that. So thank you. He was actually very lovely. that sort of broke the ice. So they don't speak in words, but Rafferty did step up and take the place that Rose was supposed to have. So in the story, of course, Rose is the one that's considered other. And I'm going to read you this last bit, and then we can talk, we can have questions and things. But this is the walk that my assistant quit. So do you remember the winter that was so awful that we had a few years back? I was writing this book during that winter, and I hate winter. That's what kept us from moving back for so long. I always try to take vacations in winter, and this year I hope to get out to LA because they're talking TV series, so we'll see. But I'm hoping that'll be the winter. My luck will probably be the summer. Anyway, I wrote this chapter during that awful winter, and well, you'll all recognize it probably. And this is Rose's chapter. In February, snow fell from the sky until it insinuated itself into everyone's consciousness. Piles grew higher and higher on the ground. Ice encased the tree branches, and on the few days the sun chose to appear, it glared with a light more blinding than summer's. At night, everything sparkled and strobed. When the short-lived annual thaw finally came, the snow and the ice melted and pooled, fooled a few of the trees attempted to quench their thirst, and when the water froze again, it split them in half. All over town, people deserted their cars, narrowing the historic streets even more. Vehicles were plowed in too many times to remember. Forced to walk, people slipped on sidewalks, fracturing ankles and cracking ribs. Old people broke their hips and died of the resultant pneumonia. One hand-lettered sign on a Salem street corner advised, "Pray for global warming." That message was crossed out and replaced with scrawling red letters, "This is global warming, asshole." Rose dressed for the cold, layering every warm item of clothing she owned under her big red coat. The boots Callie had given her for Christmas were not quite broken in, so she added extra socks to pad the heels. The train had stopped running. It was 3 a.m., too late to call for Emily's driver. So she, as she had done a few times in the past weeks, let me just step back and say, Rose believes that the secret to those killed in the 1692 witch trials whose bodies have disappeared, and I'm not talking John Proctor or Rebecca Nurse, but the others, and to the murders of 1989, will be found, has been communicated to her by trees, particularly oaks in Salem. And she feels if she finds the tree from the 1692 hangings, she will solve the murder, the mystery of the 1989 murder of her friends. Obviously, Rose is delusional, but if any of you have read The Hidden Life of Trees, have you read that this year? It's a wonderful book about tree communication and how trees communicate through their root systems and fungus, and it is an image system for this book, and in particular for the way society probably should be, and sometimes isn't, because they help each other and they don't. An oak will help an elm, for example, who needs nutrition. So it's a wonderful book if you haven't read it. It's a small book, and it just came out. I was studying the writer's papers before the book came out, but I highly recommend it. So what Rose is doing in this particular scene is she thinks she has found the tree that was the oak tree used in 1692's hangings. Of course, she is probably not right about that, but she thinks she's found it in Pride's Crossing. And it's on an estate owned by Emily, and Emily has given her permission to visit the tree anytime she wants to, and also to call her driver to pick her up. But it's 3 a.m., and Rose has to visit the tree right now during a snowstorm. The train stopped running. It was 3 a.m., too late to call for Emily's driver, as she had done a few times in the past weeks. Tonight, she would have to walk. Outside, she didn't see any vehicles save the occasional plow on the main streets. As the plows passed, the force of the wind drove the snow back, filling in the pathways behind, almost as quickly as they'd been cleared. The wind stung her face as she walked along the North River on Route 1A. She had to lean into it to keep from being pushed backward. Already, several cars had been abandoned, covered in rising snow, until they looked like a tiny mountain range along a vast white plain. When she got to the Beverly Bridge, the wind force doubled, gusting off the open water, and for a moment, Rose lost her balance completely. Determined, she righted herself and pressed on, leaning forward until her torso was practically parallel to the ground. As the bridge crested at its highest point, the screaming wind faded to an eerie stillness. Rose felt suspended in time and space. Whiteness stretched in every direction. As she descended the downward slope, the wind picked up again, and the momentary calm gave way to a renewed fury. For just a moment, Rose regretted the journey. When the bridge ended, she stayed to the right on Cabot Street. By the time she reached Route 127, she could no longer feel her feet. The snow had turned to sleet, and the road beneath her was slippery. Her fingers ached, so she balled them into fists in the palm of each glove to warm them. When she finally reached Pride's Crossing, the thick stands of trees provided relief from the sting of the attacking wind. By the time she found the Whitings' driveway, the sleet had turned back to snow. The world was quiet here, insulated, so perfect that it startled her in both its frozen beauty and its white silence. In the glow of solar lights leading to Pride's heart, Rose watched the snowflakes dance to the faint music of wind through bare elm branches. The lights were crested and glowing on their windward sides, luminaries lighting her way. As she walked past the big house, Rose looked in the window of the library and was surprised to see Emily sitting alone by the fire, reading a book by candlelight. Rose walked on toward the orangerie. The glass structure was covered with snow, its spiny frame creating a pattern that mimicked the branches of the trees. When she arrived at the oak, Rose began to cry, her tears freezing as they fell to her cheeks. She put her arms around the tree, and its branches seemed to sway forward, reaching for her, the oak pulling her close under the shelter of its heavy limbs. Rose sat down, leaning her exhausted body against the trunk, disappearing into its strong embrace. She turned her face to the oak's dark and rippled skin, her fingers clasping the bark. She could feel the thrum of life in the tree's scarred beginnings, tracing it back to birth, and then to each spring's rebirth, the unfurling light green of every new leaf. "Mother Mary, hallow this ground," she began to recite, remembering that night so long ago at Proctor's Ledge, when they tried to do a blessing and her friends had been killed. She raised her arms like the tree limbs and opened her fingers wide, imagining tiny sprouts of life springing from them, budding, blooming, greening, then vibrant with color, and finally withering and letting go. She felt her blood sap cool and slow until she could feel it no longer, and she lay down, resting under the tree, her arms spread wide like the branches of the sacred oak. And that's my favorite character.
Wow.
That's Rose. Rose's character, I tried to parallel one of the characters from 1692, in particular Sarah Good's character. What they were trying to do the night of the 1989 murders was consecrate Proctor's Ledge, and they were murdered while doing so. So to me, nothing better could have happened than when this book first went to print with the copies I gave you, the early readers' copies, was that Proctor's Ledge finally got its blessing and its memorial. And I felt like Rose had a part in it, even though she's fictional. You can see that fiction and real life kind of meld for me. Any questions?
We live in Marblehead, and I try awfully hard to make a picture of Marblehead to Salem, because we did live in Salem for a while. It's very hard to make that picture.
Well, you know where we lived? We lived, you're talking about geographically,
yeah,
coming across the harbor. We lived over behind St. Andrew's Church, up on the hill.
Oh, we were in Marblehead, too.
Yeah, just over the Marblehead line.
Oh, I see.
And my dad was a seventh generation Marbleheader. Mm-hmm. I was allowed to move to Salem, but not to Swampscott. That's a big football rivalry.
Thank you for making that clear.
Yeah, so we had a little Boston Whaler in Salem Harbor, and we would go up through Wines Woods and down to the really was the backside of the lead mills at that point, you know. So it was only negotiable at low tide. Right. And we weren't really allowed to swim there, but we kept our boat down.
Thank you for giving me two worlds today.
Yes, that's it. So I was absolutely fascinated by Salem. And I was fascinated by Marblehead too, but there was something very exotic about this place to me. And plus you had the best movie theaters at that time. So, other questions?
I have a question. I'm curious about Pride's Heart, the mansion in Pride's Crossing. Was that patterned after a specific mansion that exists, and what about that place?
You read the book, obviously. No, but my grandmother lived in Pride's Crossing when I was growing up, and my mother's mother. And there were such beautiful houses around there. And the ones that I'm thinking of, you can only see by boat. So I have one in mind, but you know, you can't really get to it, so I'm not too worried about people. And I don't know what's inside it. I've never been in it. But you probably know. You might. They're always kind of a compilation of other places.
Uh-huh.
So I took the orangerie from one house and put it on the other. The basement, however, there's a wine cellar in the basement, and an awful lot happens in the wine cellar. And I would tell you right now, stay out of the wine cellar. So. But it has very nice wine.
Yeah.
Yes. So, and that's why California's like coming out with wine country. Yeah. Other questions? Yes.
When you said a television series based on
The Fifth Petal. This has been all over the map because the Lace Reader was optioned first for a feature film. By the woman who did Practical Magic and Heathers. And that went on for about 6 months, and then it just kind of, they wrote a screenplay and it just didn't really work as a feature. I think long-form television wasn't out there then. That was 2008, and now it's the perfect vehicle for that. But they're not starting with that. They have decided, a producer and a showwriter, a showrunner from Grimm, if you've ever seen Grimm, and a producer who's produced a lot of different shows, have taken a liking to The Fifth Petal in particular, and they want to do a limited series based on it. And I'm in on all the pitches, so this is kind of fun. From here, I do a little piece on Salem, and then they take off with what they've written. But they're sticking pretty closely to this book, and then if it, they'll do a pilot in any case, but if it gets picked up, then they will go to The Map of Two Places and The Lace Reader, and the book that I'm writing next, which is called Bone Lace. So we'll see. So fingers crossed. Or do we, as Salemites, do we look? No, we do. I do. So please, cross your fingers. They promised to do it well.
Will the name of the series be The Fifth Petal, so we know what to look for?
No, the name of the series will be Gallows Hill, actually. So, I thought that was a good title and surprising. Surprise, I didn't.
They got to film it on location.
Yeah, they would film on. Well, they would do a lot in sound stages in LA or Vancouver, but all the location shots would be here. So I think they'd spend quite a bit of time. If it works, they're coming back soon to get my tour. I tried to get them here for Halloween, but they chickened out. So. They read the book and thought, no. So fingers crossed on that. I really would love to see it happen. I would love to see Salem portrayed authentically. And another writer friend of mine here is doing the same thing. So, and lately, I think we have, you know, we've had more of that. But a lot of times, what you see just doesn't it just burn you? You go, oh, come on. So anyway, we'll see. I hope so. Fingers crossed. Any other questions? This is so nice that everyone came out today. Thank you. This is the last stop on my book tour. And I'm
Thank you so much. We're so honored to have you.
Thank you.